Hello and welcome back to VMware View 5 Essentials Training. We're going to be going through the lesson installing VMware View 5. In this lesson, we're going to take a look at the system requirements for installation. We'll look at the requirements that are necessary for Active Directory integration. Then we'll take a look at the client devices that can actually be used. And then we'll take a trip through delegated authority and how that works in Vue with role-based access. And then finally, we'll take an installation walkthrough just before we go into an actual demonstration of the installation. So let's take a look at connection server system requirements. So with the connection server, you can run with Windows Server 2003 R2 and 32-bit, Windows Server 2008 R2 in 64-bit mode, and this mode is actually what's required in order for a security server to be able to have the PC over IP secure gateway. So typically, for most clients, I usually recommend Windows 2008 R2 as the default operating system. Now, when it comes to actual memory system requirements, for memory requirements, you have a 2 GB minimum for 32-bit operating systems, or a 4 GB minimum for 64-bit operating systems. And if you're going to scale beyond 50 desktops, for 32-bit, you need 6 GB of RAM or higher, and 10 GB of RAM or higher for 64-bit operating systems. For our lab environment, we'll be fine where we're at for lab purposes, but you can always start small and add additional as you need to and as your need sees fit. From a CPU perspective, quad processors are recommended, but again, as long as you have a Pentium 4 2 GHz or higher processor, you should be fine. And again, I would start small. I'd start with a single vCPU and be able to grow it from there. Since these view manager servers are going to be virtual machines anyway, it's quite easy to scale up for hardware for the CPU and for memory. So I always like to start at a minimum and grow as I need and as performance demands it. Now for the actual vSphere software that's supported, you can run on vSphere 4.0 update 3 or later, or vSphere 4.1 update 1 or later. And of course, VMware View 5 is also supported on vSphere 5 or later. Now, if you're going to be having multiple view manager servers, that is a standard and additional replica servers, those replicated sets need to be connected together over a high-speed network like a LAN, not necessarily a low-speed, high-latency network like a WAN. So if you're going to be grouping your replica and standard servers together, you really don't want to be spreading them across low-speed WAN links. You want to keep them together on high-speed LAN links. Now the transfer server system requirements. It needs to be managed by the same vCenter as the local mode desktops that you're going to be checking out. So the actual transfer server itself as a virtual machine needs to be managed by that same vCenter. So you can't have it managed by a separate vCenter server from the local mode desktops. I've seen this happen occasionally when I have a management cluster which handles all my management virtual machines and then a separate cluster that may be managed by a separate vCenter server. Now you can't do that with the transfer server if you're going to be checking out local mode desktops. It needs to be within the same vCenter server as where those local mode desktops are going to reside. Now the transfer server and also the view manager servers also need static IP addresses. So that's a requirement. You can't use DHCP or DHCP with reservations. The installer will not let you proceed without a static IP address on those systems. And for the transfer server itself, you also need to make sure that you use the LSI Logic Parallel SCSI controller. It is not the default controller, so you need to make sure when you're actually creating the virtual machine for the transfer server that you choose a custom and not the typical option for creating a virtual machine. That way you can select the LSI Logic Parallel SCSI controller. And it can't coexist with other view manager roles, so you can't have a transfer server that also acts as a replica, a standard server, a view composer server. None of that's going to be possible. It needs to be a standalone role on a standalone system. Now the repository disk, which is where all of the checked out virtual machines are going to reside, needs to have enough space to be able to store those composer base images. So as you're looking at your pools, especially if they're linked clone pools, you need to look at the size of the initial composer base disk and know what that total size is going to be and provide for enough space in the repository to be able to handle however many link clone virtual machines that you plan on allowing users checking out. So that's not one per each individual user. You just need to have one per each unique pool that's based off a unique parent base image from VueComposer. So the ESXi server that's hosting the transfer server must also have access to the data stores that contain the desktop disks that you're going to be checking out. So it can't be an ESXi host that doesn't have that particular data store or LUN zone to it. It needs to be able to have that access because it's going to mount up that disk to the transfer server in order to be able to check that out to the individual virtual machines. And this is something of note. It's not something you need to really do anything with, but the transfer server installation is going to put DRS into manual mode for the transfer server to avoid the transfer server from being able to automatically migrate or vMotion across multiple hosts. So it'll essentially pin it to a host. It'll do that for you, so you don't have to worry about it, but it is something to be aware of. So for VueComposer, let's look at its requirements. Now, it needs to be installed on the vCenter server, and because of that, you're going to have the same vCenter server requirements. So depending on which vCenter server version you're running, you're going to have to follow the same operating system guidelines for that vCenter server as for VueComposer. So not much to worry about on the VueComposer side. You just need to be able to install it on the vCenter server itself. And listed below are the different operating system versions depending on the version of vCenter server. And likely you will have already prepared for this because your vCenter server will hopefully be at the level you want it to be. But if you're transitioning from, say, vCenter 4.0 update 3 or below to vCenter 4.1 or 5, you will have to go through the migration path of getting off of a 32-bit vCenter server and getting onto a 64-bit vCenter server system. And you can follow along in VMware's documentation guides for upgrading vCenter. They've got a very good process for going through that. So the Composer database requirements. VueComposer does require its own database. It can live on the same SQL instance as the vCenter database, but it does need to be a separate database within that same instance. Now listed in the table below, I have a listing of the different databases that are supported under which vCenter server versions. So find out which vCenter server version you're running and pick an appropriate database. But again, if you're going to be installing it on the same SQL Server instance as VirtualCenter's database server, you'll be fine because that'll line up for VueComposer as well. So Composer's feature requirements. So the following features are only available for linked clone pools when you're using vSphere mode on ESX4 or later hosts. So the utilization of local data stores. So the ability to actually have your linked clones using local data stores instead of expensive SAN storage. So that allows you to take and offload that to the local disks. Obviously, you can't vMotion those particular desktops, or DRS won't be able to, nor will high availability work for that, but that does allow you to achieve some savings if you don't want to use expensive SAN storage for your desktops. It also gives you the ability to have disposable data disks. So these are data disks that when the user logs off are essentially wiped and thrown away. Things for the paging file, temporary internet files, transient files that are typically logged. It also allows you to have separation of disks across data stores. So then I can actually do disk tiering. So I can have tiers 1, 2, or 3 for my disks depending on what type of speed that I need, whether that's just SATA, SAS, or fiber channel, or SSD drives. So depending on what my I/O requirements are for those particular portions of disk, I can put them on the appropriate speed disk and tier those separately when it comes to the actual link clone versus the replica versus the disposable disks versus the persistent or user data disks. Now, parent virtual machines with hardware version 7 or higher are required with this as well, as is using sysprep for link clones, which is new for 4.1. So the Vue agent system requirements. So it can be installed on Windows 7 Enterprise or Professional 32 or 64-bit, or Windows Vista Business or Enterprise 32-bit, or Windows XP Professional 32-bit. So those are the operating systems that you can use for the agents when you're doing virtual desktop pools. Now you can also install the agent on terminal server as well. So I have the ability for 2008 R2, 2008, 2003 R2, and 2003 terminal servers to be able to install the agent on and allow VueManager to be a broker for folks connecting to a terminal server. Now, the client system requirements are pretty broad. So Windows 7 Home, Enterprise, Professional, or Ultimate 32 or 64-bit are supported, as is Windows Vista, Home, Enterprise, Business, or Ultimate, the Surface Pack 1 or Surface Pack 2 for 32-bit, or Windows XP Home or Professional, Surface Pack 3 or higher with 32-bit. Now, Mac OS X, Leopard, and Snow Leopard are also supported as clients. You don't get all the feature sets when you install the View Client on the Mac OS X operating systems. Multimedia redirection, some of the USB redirection that doesn't actually work with those particular clients. And clients with local mode are only supported on physical Windows systems, not on virtual machines. Another thing that isn't in the slide deck here, but you can also not install client with local mode if you're already running VMware Workstation or VMware Player on your local operating system as well. Now for Thin Client devices, check the Thin Client compatibility guide in order to see which versions of Thin Client and their particular firmware or operating system versions are supported or have the ability to have the VMware View Client pre-installed. So clients with local mode, there's some specific hardware requirements that are necessary for local mode. So one of which is you cannot check out a desktop that's running virtual hardware version 8 with local mode. So virtual hardware version 8 was introduced in vSphere 5. And so if you're going to be using local mode, you need to make sure that the virtual desktops that you're creating are actually virtual hardware version 7 or earlier, because version 8 will not be supported to be checked out. And I think I'd mentioned this before, but it bears repeating. So the hardware that you're actually running and going to be checking out the virtual desktop on and running it locally on, you need to be able to support both running the native OS as well as the virtual machine at the same time. So if I don't have enough resources, CPU, disk, memory, in order to run both at the same time, then that's not going to function and that's not going to work really well for you. So definitely make sure you do your homework ahead of time for any of your users that will be using local mode, and make sure that they've got enough resources to run both at the same time. So if you want to be able to run Windows Aero or Windows 7 virtual desktops within local mode, you're going to need at least an Intel dual core processor or an AMD Athlon 4200 or above. And for the GPU chipsets, you need to be running the NVIDIA GeForce 8800 GT or the ATI Radeon HD 2600 or higher in order to allow that. And if you're going to want to run 64-bit virtual desktops in local mode, you're going to need an Intel Pentium 4 Core 2 or Core i7 processor, and they need to have the latest Intel VT instructions that's on those particular processors. And most AMD 64 processors, except the earliest Revision C Opteron processors, will work as well from an AMD perspective. So as we look at the protocol requirements, for PC over IP, I really need dual virtual CPUs if I'm going to be running 720p or 1080p video, or I also will need dual virtual CPUs in order to run full screen 480p video on Windows 7. Now, the recommended guest RAM for Windows XP is 768 meg or higher, and 1 gig or higher for Windows 7, and also the SSE2 extensions necessary on the processor to really take advantage of PC over IP's benefits. And if I'm going to run 3D applications like Aero on the Windows 7 virtual machine, it must be running virtual hardware version 8. So this is only an option if you're on vSphere 5 or higher. It's not supported on vSphere 4.1 or earlier. And like we mentioned earlier with local mode, this would be a conflict of interest. You can't run local mode with 3D applications because you need the virtual hardware version 8. So that only would be able to run remotely in the data center. And for RDP, you need version 6.x or higher, which is included in Windows Vista and 7. So our feature-specific requirements, multimedia redirection. So the client must be a Windows XP, an XP embedded or Vista client, or Windows 7 for that matter. And it needs to be running Windows Media Player 10 or higher. And it only supports a subset of the actual video formats out there. And listed there are all the different formats that it does currently support. Adobe Flash Control is only for versions 9 or 10 and must use Internet Explorer. And you're not going to be able to use full screen mode with Adobe Flash. And for smart cards, the best practices are usually to install the drivers both in the clients that you're connecting from and the virtual desktop that you're connecting to. And it'll support the 1024 2048-bit key size with PKCS number 11 or Microsoft Crypto's API. So the requirements for Active Directory integration, you're going to really want to place your view desktops in the same domain as the connection server, or at least a domain with a two-way trust relationship. Now, the security server I mentioned doesn't actually have to be directly authenticating users. It's going to pass that through onto the view connection servers and your internal LAN. So it doesn't actually have to be inside of the Active Directory trust zone. So if your security servers are on the DMZ as they should be with best practices, and you don't have an Active Directory environment or a trust relationship out to the DMZ for Active Directory, it's okay to have your security servers there without being joined to a domain. And ideally, you're also going to want to create a new OU for your view desktops to be placed into when they're created. And the reasons for this are going to be based on allowing group policy objects to be applied to those OUs to affect those virtual desktops and control that virtual desktop image. You're also going to need to create dedicated OUs and groups for Kiosk Mode clients, because that's a requirement in order for Kiosk Mode to function. And you're going to want to create groups based on pool and application access. Because basically, the pools that you create are going to be based on typically a business unit or around a set of application sets. So you're going to want to create groups that mirror that relationship on those types of pools, so that when you entitle a pool, you can entitle just that group to have access to the pool. Now, you're also going to need at least one service account and Active Directory in order to allow you to be able to access vCenter, and also for View Composer to be able to add computer accounts to AD. Now, the details are in the View Installation Guide for the permissions that are necessary in order to allow access for View to vCenter and for View Composer to install computer accounts. And the permissions are similar enough that you can probably get away with one service account. Some people like to break it up and have two service accounts, one for the access for View to vCenter and then a separate one for View Composer to be able to create accounts in Active Directory. But for simplicity's sake, I like to be able to just use one account. Now also, all users that need to actually get access to those desktops need to be added to the remote desktop users group on the local virtual desktop. So there's a couple of ways to be able to do this. I like to be able to use restricted groups in Active Directory group policy to specify who the group membership is going to be of the remote desktop users group in those virtual desktops. And I'll either use something like domain users, or I'll create a brand new view users group and then place all users that need to have access to virtual desktops inside of that group. Either one of those methods works quite well. You just need to make sure that those are in there. And also, so you know, giving domain users access to the virtual desktops does not grant them access to the virtual desktops. They still have to come through the View Manager server and be entitled to a particular desktop pool before they're going to be granted access.
And then finally, VMware supplies group policy templates as part of the install on the View Manager servers. So you can import these templates into Active Directory and allow you to be able to control access to the virtual desktops, the View Manager servers, to the security servers, to the View Client. So there's a lot of control they give you within those group policy administrative templates. And with View 5, there's some really great enhancements to the PC over IP control as well. So you get a lot of granular control with these group policy administrative templates. So definitely make use of them.
So for client devices, we have a couple different types of client devices we can use. One of them is thin clients. So these are going to be running Windows XP embedded, a slimmed down version of Linux, or their own proprietary OS like Weiss's Thin OS. There's also zero client options, which is essentially like firmware, where the thin client, the client actually boots up and boots directly to the network and connects to the View Manager server in your desktop. So it's one of the more seamless ways to be able to connect with a zero client. You also have the option of repurposing your PCs. I like suggesting this for my clients because there is a lot of cost in getting virtual desktops into the enterprise. And so any type of cost savings that you can provide to your enterprise is really beneficial. So taking your old systems can still connect in and provide a decent enough experience either over PC over IP or RDP will really be utilized quite well if you can repurpose them. There's some third-party products out there that will help you to be able to do that, to be able to essentially turn those old desktops into like a thin client that just has the View client in there and launches that directly into your virtual desktop. So definitely something to take a look at. And then you also have the option of BYOPC, right? Allow your users or your consultants or contractors to come in and bring in their own PCs and then give them access to the Vue client to be able to connect to a virtual desktop that gives them access to your network. So delegated authority. Within Vue Manager, there's role-based access that has been set up. And essentially what that is a set of roles have been predefined, which have a collection of privileges and give certain type of access for that particular role. So what you'll do is you'll take and grant Active Directory users or groups to one or more of those administrative roles. And then you can take and create folders and arrange pools into those folders and then grant those particular roles on those specific folders. So that way those users that have been given those particular administrative roles within Vue only have a limited subset. So a great example of this is you might want to have a certain set of users only being able to have inventory access to your certain subset of pools, but not all pools across the board. So this gives you some granular ability to be able to set up these folders and these individual role-based authorization methods in order to give the right amount of privileges to the right people. So real quickly, we're going to go through the installation process before we actually jump into the demo and go through the installation process there. So initially, you're going to install your first connection server. Then you'll want to go over to the Virtual Center server and install the Vue Composer. Then you'll want to come back to your connection server and configure both the connection server and Vue Composer. Then you can install additional replica servers as needed and configure security servers out in your DMZ to connect back to those individual connection servers. You can install your configure your transfer server if you're going to be doing local mode operations. And then finally, you can look at configuring any role-based authorizations that you need to provide the right type of access for administrative access to those particular pools. All right. Now here we are on the Vue Connection Server, and I have the Vue Connection Server software already loaded onto the C drive here. So from here, what we're going to do to start off and get the Vue Manager Server installed is just double-click on that software, and it will bring up the Vue Connection Server wizard. Alright, so it just says, welcome to the wizard. Let's go ahead and click next. And here are all the wonderful patent agreements. You're welcome to read through those. There's quite a few there. And let's accept the end user license agreement. Otherwise, we're not moving forward at all. Click next. We have the default to change where the default destination folder is. But we're fine with the defaults as is on the C drive there. We'll click next. So here, as you can see, this one installer is actually the installer for the standard server, the replica, the security, and the transfer server all in one installation piece. So since this is our first Vue Connection server, we're going to select the default, which is the Vue Standard server, and we will click next. And we can allow the installer to configure the Windows Firewall automatically, which will automatically open up the necessary ports for communication to the Vue Administrator server, as well as the Vue servers to other Vue servers,
and all the ports that are necessary. So let's click next.
And it tells us where it's going to install to. We're going to go ahead and click on install. So it's going to go through the process of copying the new files. And as you can see now, it's adding the Active Directory Lightweight Directory Service server role, which is the Atom Active Directory Application Mode LDAP database that it uses for all of its configuration settings. So it's setting that database up currently right now and setting it up as the VMware VDMDS Directory Services instance, which is that LDAP database, which we will see in the services area that's set up as a VMware service. And it's now importing all the LDIF files for the schema for that directory service. Alrighty, and the installation is finished. Now, if you'll notice, there's an actual warning here. saying that I have a limited amount of memory available here. That's because it's a lab environment and I haven't set it to the recommended settings for the amount of memory that it wants. If you set the recommended memory, you won't run into this warning. Click finish. So now we have the View Administrator Console icon on our desktop. So if we double click on that and launch that, it'll come up and it has a security certificate warning. Now this is because it's using a self-signed certificate. In a real live enterprise environment, you probably want to use your own self-signed or root enterprise trust certificates to be used in place of the existing self-signed certificate from VMware. So we're going to just go ahead and say continue in this place. Now, VMware View Administrator does run on Adobe Flash, so you'll need to have Adobe Flash, latest version of that, 10, version 10 running in order to be able to access the View Administrator. So I'm going to log on with my credentials here. And we'll log on. And you'll notice it brings us right up to the licensing and usage place where right now there is no valid license. So you can go ahead and click on Edit License and enter in your license key there. So now I've added in my license key. So you'll notice that the license expiration is now set to never, and the View Composer license and the Local Mode licenses are now enabled. So from within there, we're going to look at some of the view configuration a little bit later, so we're going to come back to this place now. But for right now, let's go ahead and exit out of the View Administrator. And we're going to now connect into the View Composer and do the View Composer installation. Here we are now on the Virtual Center server, and I've already copied over the VMware View Composer installer onto the C drive of the Virtual Center server. And I've also already configured the the View Composer database, as well as the View Event database on the SQL server that's also on this vCenter server as well, and created a SQL user account called vCenter that we'll use to connect to that View Composer and View Event database. So let's go ahead and run the installer. Alrighty. So now that the installation wizard is loaded, we'll go ahead and click Next. Again, we have all the patent agreements and the end user license agreement, which we will accept, and click Next. And then we will leave the default location for the VMware View Composer installer to install to the C drive. Click Next. And so now we're going to enter the data source name. So as you'll see, we'll go to our ODBC data sources and system DSN, and I already have a data source named Composer, so we're going to use that data source name here. And the SQL username that we're using is vCenter, and my super secret password, and we'll click Next. Now it does use SOAP, so there is automatically a default SOAP port that's open. And there were no default SSL certificates found on our machine, so it's going to create a self-signed SSL cert for us. So we can go ahead and click Next on that. And it's telling us where it's going to install to, and we will click Install. And now that the install is completed, we will go ahead and click Finish. And it wants us to go ahead and restart this computer, which we will go ahead and do, and say yes. So here we are back at the View Administrator on VueCon 01. And I went ahead and logged in, and now under the View Configuration on the Servers tab. So as you'll see now, we now have our View Connection server listed in here. It's in an enabled state, and we could actually go in and edit this or back up the server, or specify a security server password, which we'll do when we go to create the first security server here as well. So if I go ahead and click on Edit, you'll see a little bit of sessions here of whether or not to use this as a secure gateway for PCIe connections, whether or not I'm using a secure tunnel to connect to this particular view server. I also have the option to be able to separate view connection servers logically with tags. so that certain pools that are created are only accessible through certain view manager servers as well. I have some local mode settings here as well where I can use deduplication or compression for local mode, whether or not I can use SSL for local mode or operations or provisioning local mode, and whether or not I use a secure tunnel for local mode regular operations. I can also enforce RSI ID token connection here as well, so that when users connect to these particular view manager servers to their desktops, they're required or have the option of using an RSA token. And then I can also set up a backup schedule for the view configuration as well, as to how often it will back up and at what time and how many max number of backups to take before it rolls over. Click cancel on here. And here we are now back on the view connection server. And now I've logged in and gotten us to the server section for the view configuration. So we can add in our vCenter server and connect it to our view composer service as well. So we're going to go ahead and click the add button here. And I'm going to type in the fully qualified name of the vCenter server. And then I'm going to type a local admin account for the vCenter server to get administrative privileges back to vCenter. And then I'm going to check the box to enable View Composer. And so the little icon, time glass icon, has stopped recording, so it's able to now connect to the View Composer service on the vCenter server. And we're going to click the add button. And what we're going to add in is a domain account. We're going to specify the full domain name of home.int. And the username .int/view service. And this is the account that actually has access to be able to create and delete computer accounts within the domain, so that as the composer service is creating the link clones, it's able to then use this account to create those computer accounts in Active Directory. And so that domain now shows up in our listing for here. So if I have multiple domains, I need to make sure I have multiple accounts that are listed for each domain that I need to add. We'll click OK. Now you'll see that our vCenter server is now in place. We'll come back to this section in just a bit here. We've already looked at the product licensing and usage, so we've already edited in our license. We also have global settings for the view administrator server. You can edit each one of these settings individually, but essentially this is the global session timeout for how long the you'll be able to access the view administrator before it times out and requires an additional logon. We can also set up SSL client connections for or clients that are connecting into the desktops and for view administrator, or we can turn that off. The default settings that are all listed here are all fine and perfect for what we need. We can require clients to re-authenticate if the tunnel connection drops for whatever reason. And by default, we don't want them to do that. We want their desktop experience to be as seamless as possible. Now, with message security mode, this one actually has a couple of different options. So by default, it's disabled, but I can either choose mixed or enabled to enable security as encryption for the communication between view administrator servers and replica servers. So if I have this in mixed mode, it's not going to enforce encryption, but it will allow it if one of the other servers is configured for it, or enabled forces the encryption to take place no matter what. We can also disable single sign-on for local mode operations. Again, we want the user experience to be seamless, and so what this will do for local mode is when the user logs into the client, it'll pass through the credentials of the actual local logon where they're already logged on, all the way to the virtual desktop, so they don't have to log on a second time. Now, the enabling of automatic status updates, what that'll actually do is, in the upper left-hand corner here, that section that's grayed out, there is a set of statistical information about the health of the environment. Now, if we check that box to enable automatic updates, it will keep that area up to date, but it will also continually be adding to the timeout value. So the session timeout will never time out. So that can be a potential security risk. So we're not going to enable that, even though that is a nice feature to have. We also have a pre-logon message displayed, and this would be your typical legal warning preventing people from accessing this computer if they aren't authorized to do so. Just your little legal disclaimer. And then we also have the ability to set a default warning when users are forced to log off for any operations like a recompose operation where the virtual machine would need to have some downtime and need to be rebooted or reassembled. So you can set the amount of time that they have before they're forced to log off, and you can also set what the text of that message is. Now, if we click on the registered desktop sources, these would be physical PCs or terminal servers that actually have the View Agent installed on them, and we would see them listed here if we had any that were registered with this View Administrator, which we don't, so that's perfectly normal. And the Administrators area, remember when we talked back about delegated access? So this is where we can set up that information here. So we can add a user or group from Active Directory and give them a particular permission. So there are some default roles that are actually included, and we'll go to the roles tab here in just a second. But these roles can be assigned to a user or group within Active Directory. And here you can see where we can actually define those roles or add a new role if we want to look at what the privileges and the permissions are for these particular roles, what they're able to do. So you can get pretty granular as far as what you want users to be able to do when they log into the View environment,
whether they have a view-only mode or whether they can administer the environment.
And then finally, the roles are applied to the default root folder unless you actually add a new folder. So if we wanted to add a new folder, this new folder could get a permission or a set of administrators applied to here. So we can look for the View Service account. And then apply a specific role to that. So if we only wanted them to be able to view information, that way whenever that person logged in, they would only have access to those pools that were defined under the kiosks folder, and then would only then have a view-only access into that particular folder. Go ahead and remove that folder for right now. The ThinApp configuration, currently there's nothing here, and we're going to get to this more in another lesson, but this is essentially where we would add a repository, which is essentially a file share of where our ThinApp binaries would be located. That View could then scan and use for desktop or pool access. The event database has currently not been set up.
We'll get there later as well. The transfer server has not been configured, nor has the transfer repository been set up, and we'll cover that setup procedure a little bit later.
So what have we covered here today? So first of all, we've covered system requirements. We've taken a look at what's necessary and needed for all those different operating system installs. We've taken a look at the security requirements. We've looked at the different types of client devices. We've taken a look at delegated authority and how to provide RBAC access into the View environment. And we've gone through a quick installation walkthrough.